Hi, Mary Larson from the NAMM Foundation, and welcome to the Grand Rally for Music Education. I'm sorry we're not together in Anaheim this year when we could raise our voices in a cheer celebrating music education and all the work that we try to do to make music education strong. First of all, thank you for all the work you have done this last many months to make sure music education is part of our every child's life in our communities. Today, we're celebrating music education through the thoughts and feelings of remarkable people, Renèe Fleming, Gustavo Dudamel, Nina Kraus, and Liliana Morales. This event is for you, for your compassion and dedication to music education. Sit back, enjoy some great inspiration. I am just thrilled to have with me two remarkable, accomplished, and beautiful women who are joining me here at the Grand Rally for Music Education. World-renowned soprano, Renèe Fleming, and equally renowned music researcher, Dr. Nina Kraus. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Something our audience is always interested in, because we care so much about music education, is your own very personal, I like to call it the music education origin story, going back to those early influences that created you your desire to be on the path that's taking you to this time in your life. Renèe, we'd love to hear from you at the beginning, the musical beginnings of your life, your influences, the teachers, and what set you on this remarkable journey to your artistry today.
Sure. Well, I am actually the poster child for music education because because both of my parents were high school vocal music teachers. And I had education from them every day. I thought everybody sang all the time and wrote music and played music and improvised. And then I had a terrific K through 12 education with very enriched, especially middle school and high school education, really extraordinary musicals the whole time. I learned how to play guitar in a guitar class, and each one of these experiences had a major influence on me as a musician, as an artist, and as a human being. And then I went to the State University of New York in Potsdam, which has a renowned school of music called Crane. And I went to the Eastman School of Music. I went to Juilliard, and I had a Fulbright scholarship and studied in Germany. So I had a spectacular education. And of course, all of it having to do with learning about music and learning how to perform, learning about singing and my voice. Very lucky.
But you had a phenomenal base, right? I mean, you ended up being a soprano, a little pun intended there, but you had your base of musicianship was just part of your education. Right.
You know, and it's interesting because when I hear young singers, even in an audition setting, I almost always know who's had that because their pitch is great. Their musicianship is great. They have imagination. And all of these things really point to artistry. There are great singers who haven't had that background and who just have extraordinary voices and can kind of wrestle them into shape. But having that bass also has enabled me to sing a lot of new music because your musicianship skills are on such a higher level. Mm-hmm. So I'm really grateful for it.
And, you know, the connection to Crane is so wonderful because we have a real strong connection to the Crane School of Music. I actually was an executive in residence there at the School of Music a little while back. And so many of the students come to the NAMM show as part of our Gen Next program. So another connection. Nina Kraus, you took a scientific path in this world, but we know that you have a strong musical journey as well. What's your origin story?
Yeah, well, I luckily grew up with a mommy who played the piano, and I loved to just live underneath the piano whenever I could. And I grew up in a house where more than one language was spoken. And one of the languages I learned was harmony. And, it occurs to me, you know, it's this unique, Renèe, you'll, of course, have experienced this so much, this simultaneousness of hearing yourself and your partner, and you're adjusting your motor self based on what you're hearing. And it's a marriage, a sensitivity to the other person and the space between you. And to me, that's really emblematic of what sound is. You know, sound connects us to each other and to the world. But so, you know, I guess I must have thought that sound was important deeply. I went to college and majored in comparative literature and then took biology and discovered that I loved that and was able to make some connections with the biological foundations of language, which excited me. And then when I decided to go to graduate school and to study the biology of sound processing in the brain, I was looking at single neuron activity in response to sound and seeing how that changed during learning. So I also learned that music is the best example of auditory learning, because the hearing brain is vast and it consists of our motor system, how we think and feel and move. Music is just a wonderful way of studying learning. And then I guess along the way, I have learned to play some instruments, not especially well, but with tremendous joy. And so really, I've just been studying that there's so many topics of our lives that fit under the umbrella of sound in the brain.
So this remarkable alchemy has come together with Renèe Fleming, an artist we all travel miles and miles and hours to hear when we can, and a scientific pursuit, and you've joined together with some very interesting initiatives. First of all, how did that happen, and what are you doing together?
Well, we met actually at a conference table at the National Institutes of Health because I had the extraordinary good fortune to meet Francis Collins. Dr. Collins runs the National Institutes of Health at a dinner party. And I had just been appointed as a consultant to the Kennedy Center. And I asked him about all this research I kept reading about, the scientists looking at music in the brain. And I said, why is that? And I didn't realize that he was such a fabulous amateur musician himself and a triple threat, composer, you know, player of multiple instruments and singer. And he, you know, we started this conversation about the two institutes really coming together and amplifying the work of science and providing a platform for the work of science. And that has just taken off like a house on fire. It's been amazing. And Nina was really one of the first scientists who was brought to the NIH to kind of give a presentation on her work so that the NIH could kind of get a grasp of the whole field at large. And this has led to them giving $20 million in funding to this intersection of neuroscience and the brain in particular and the arts, which is so exciting. And it's taken off in so many other directions as well, with the NEA funding now a resource center. And they've chosen UCSF to kind of put together this Sound Health Initiative, which is, I think it's premiering this week or next week. And then I'm also involved with a NeuroArts Blueprint, which is a Johns Hopkins and Aspen Institute organization. This is a kind of they're trying very ambitiously to create a whole new field that's beyond music. It goes all the way to the humanities, to architecture, to everything that's about neuroaesthetics and our ability to process beauty and feeling and emotion through our senses. So it's all been incredibly exciting for me. And wherever I perform now, I give a presentation and invite scientists to join me and connecting performing arts venues and organizations with their local healthcare providers and researchers. And I can tell you, audiences are fascinated and they want more and more and more. So Anina and I keep trying to dream up things to do together, certainly in Chicago when I'm there. And again, the audiences are just loving it.
I think you're telling us too, the audiences are hungry for it, right? There's a certain sensibility that you're helping them understand. What a beautiful synergy or alchemy that's occurred between the two of you. And I love that you're taking this to the world in the same way you are with your artistry. But Nina, I'd love you to take us on a deeper dive about and we've been so honored to fund some of this work through the NAMM Foundation. It's been such a vital collaboration with us. What is science telling us about why, you know, why this is, why music is so important in our lives developmentally? And, you know, also why Renèe is having some of the experience she's having with her audiences when she brings these two worlds together. We'd love you to hear a little bit about your current perspectives.
Well, Mary, let me take your question in two directions. I'd like to talk about rhythm, and then I would like to talk about something that Renèe kind of touched on, is what music can tell us about ourselves. So first with rhythm, I mean, rhythm is pervasive outside of music. It's in our heartbeat. We walk. Our very breathing is rhythmic, there are rhythms in the brain, so that's where I come in, and it is a real challenge to bring together how is it that the rhythms in the brain sync up with the external rhythms and sound. Then there are rhythms within rhythms. So in music, we have the beat, which is signified by the time signature, and that gives us what to pay attention to. It lets us predict. It gives us confidence. There is the pattern. And the pattern, the rhythmic patterns, are signified by the rests and by the note durations. So speech too has rhythms, and they occur across these different time scales. And the way the brain makes sense of the beats and the patterns is, you know, what enables us to communicate with each other, what enables us to hear ourselves or hear each other, especially in crowded places. And rhythm therapies work, I think, from a physical and neurologic standpoint, because our brains likewise work on these different timescales of rhythms, the rhythm patterns and the underlying beats, and making music strengthens this fundamental infrastructure. Now in my lab, we are looking at rhythm with children and language and their development, and it's my expectation that we will be using brain rhythms to predict more and more what child is going to have difficulty learning to read or with other language skills. And we can use rhythms in the brain to monitor treatment options. The other area that we were taking rhythm is with head injury and concussion, because it turns out that if you get hit in the head, you can disrupt some of the brain rhythms that sync up with sound. And we want to take this a step further, which is also to use rhythm as a therapy for athletes to help ameliorate some of the cognitive symptoms that accompany a concussion. So now let me just say, you know, what can music tell us about ourselves? And I think that now we're in a position where we can start asking some of the questions that are as much in the wheelhouse of philosophers as of biologists. And Renèe, you mentioned beauty, consciousness, the nature of self, deep questions about the nature of spirituality, mind, body, brain, and music, I really believe can help probe some of these big questions. And let me just illustrate with two examples. One is memory. You know, music and memory are very tightly linked. And, you know, even before we wrote history down, history was carried forward by the bards. Most of us learned our alphabet through the ABC song. And then if you look at people with who have real severe memory loss with dementia and no longer recognize their loved ones, hearing music that was part of the soundtrack of their lives can bring them back into the world, even if only fleetingly. But doesn't this tell us? Music tells us who we are. The other example is... has to do with physical and mental healing. And Ted Gioia wrote a book called Healing Songs, and he talks about an order of Benedictine monks who were kept from chanting for a while. And when they stopped chanting, they became tired and listless and bodily ill. Their disease rates skyrocketed. And it was only after they reinstated the chanting that their physical health returned. So you know, with music reaching in so many realms, corporally and intellectually, I think that it can provide a holistic probe into unanswered questions in biological science and philosophy. You know, what would this look like? I don't know, but having this initiative with the NIH Sound Health Initiative and with the NEA, with NAMM, making this now possible. I mean, take it, I'm a scientist who for many years, music was never something that was in the, you know, fit under the umbrella of sound and the brain as a conventional auditory neuroscientist, but now it does. And I think that it opens up a whole new world. And with these initiatives, I think we can begin, first of all, to ask some of these questions and then to begin to answer them.
You know, it's so interesting to me, Nina, that you talk about that, because one of the things I had to learn right away, because there are things that we take for granted as musicians. We know that music is healing because we have people come backstage who said, your music got me through this loss or this illness or this tragedy in my life. And they don't ever forget that. And it's a very powerful force for people. And it's not necessarily me. It can be anything. It's whatever you love. But getting science to pay attention to it requires a level of data gathering and a level of really, I call it sort of a mosaic, you know, from the lowest level of this. That was the first thing I learned. It's like, my goodness, the actual research is so micromanaged, and it has to be built up over a long period of time before science will unequivocally say this is powerful and it works. But they're starting to. It's happening.
Yeah, and I mean, I can really tell you that I have seen firsthand how making music changes the brain. It changes sound processing in the brain in ways that strengthen language and our ability to think. You know, I mean, sound, of course, consists of pitch and timing and timbre. These ingredients are in music and in language. So when we measure brain responses in children who are engaged in a music education, we see that the way they process these sound ingredients is more precise, it's strengthened, it's purer. And we've also found that music is a powerful way to overcome deficits in sound processing that come along with economic disadvantage often. I mean, you know, making music really affects who we are biologically and how we engage with the world.
No, it's beautiful to hear you both speak about this, because you've arrived on kind of separate journeys, which are now parallel and are overlapping from the perspective of beauty and artistry and the art of science, you know, being a very engaged scientist. But you say unequivocally the power of music exists and has these results and impacts. And I think when we all can say this definitively and being able to describe it through our various means, we can create the world we're all hoping for as we move forward. I could talk about this all day, and maybe someday we will. We'll have to find our way to a conference, or we'll have to create a conference. We should make that a. But I'd like to sort of end with a series of sort of quick questions, all right, in a little bit of a quick round-robin format. So, Renèe, to you, if there is a concert venue you're dying to return to, which one is it? Where is it?
Oh my gosh. You know, any of them, any and all. I have been out of work now for almost a year, and I think it's going to be a long time still because I'm committed to not really getting on planes and certainly flying internationally until I have the vaccine. So I'd be so grateful to perform anywhere. Now, I did have one performance at the Kennedy Center in July with Vanessa Williams, which was a lot of fun, really great fun. I can't tell you, it's a whole different feeling to perform when you've taken it for granted for your whole adult life, and then it's taken away.
Yeah, well, we can't wait either. Nina, where do you hope to return to in terms of being an audience member?
Well, I would like to hear Monteverdi's Vespers in a cathedral.
Anywhere in the world, maybe, right?
Anywhere.
Right.
But you know, actually one of my sons is in Cambridge in the UK, so they have a pretty nice cathedral over there.
Let's go.
One of the things that I look forward to is seeing my children and singing songs with them, and to Renee's point, I really look forward to talking about science and the brain and sound to a live audience.
Right. And my final question are, what are you most hopeful for 2021? Renee?
Oh my gosh, everything has to get better, please. Please. I live close to DC. I biked to the Capitol 2 days ago to see for myself. And I'm most hopeful for some semblance of unity in the country, the breaking down of this terrible division that is mostly caused by people's access to their own track, whatever track that they most appreciate, and which then, of course, they imagine that everyone else is on the same track, and we're not. So we need to center, and we need to find and decide what truth is. So that is absolutely the thing. And of course, I'm also very hopeful that these vaccines will be distributed much more quickly so that we can safely return to our lives.
Nina, what are you most hopeful for?
Yeah, so Renee, truth with a capital T. As kids go back to school and we get the opportunity to rethink our healthcare, I'm hopeful that we will move towards a society which makes music an integral part of education and medicine.
To both of you.
I have a 1-year-old grandson now, and to watch him respond to music in the last year has been the most powerful validation of everything I've learned with these projects, because it is such a strong reaction. The minute a beat comes on, he is full of joy and he is dancing.
Yeah.
It takes 1 second for him to respond, and nobody taught him that.
Yeah. And as you know, you are who you came into the world. You were fortunate to have music around you. I mean, we are, and like I see this as a biologist, we are what we do. You know, biologically, we are what we do. And you know, in terms of being hopeful, we have to. I'm hopeful that we will make good decisions for how we personally spend our time, how our children, our grandchildren spend their time, and how our society spends its time. And music is such a huge, huge part of what makes us biologically who we are.
And performers learn to empathy. Empathy is a huge part of the arts and what it is that we learn from both reading, doing plays. It's also part of history, because all of the arts really show us what it's been to be human over millennia, and certainly over the last, in modern history, 400 or 500 years. And that teaches us really, it gives us a perspective, I think, that's incredibly useful.
I'm so grateful to both of you. You both give me so much hope for 2021 and beyond. And I hope we have many more opportunities to work together. So thank you so very much. And thank you for being part of our Grand Rally and making sure music education is strong in the lives of all of our children and in all people. Thank you so much.
You're here. Thank you, Mary.
Yeah. Mary, thank you for what you do.
Yes.
Thank you. Wasn't that a fun conversation with Renèe and Nina? The fact that their worlds have overlapped and they're creating this remarkable new insight about the impact of music making and learning. I hope you'll be a part of a national campaign, theartsareeducation.org, where you can be involved with your local school district and community to make sure we have strong music and arts programs for every child as we move past this COVID period and as children return to school. Please join us. And our next conversation will be sure to inspire you for the value of music in their lives and how we all need to work together to promote music education. Enjoy. We have remarkable guests with us here for the Grand Rally, and I'm so delighted to have with me Maestro Gustavo Dudamel and Liliana Morales. Welcome. So wonderful to have you.
Thank you.
You know, our audience that gathers here at the Grand Rally is comprised of people that are really dedicated to music education and the future of music. And they're very concerned that we are all serving as advocates and champions for music education because we believe in its power and its impact in the world. And we all love to share in your music education origin stories. Where did you start for both of you? How did you start? What was your most inspiring teachers? We know that teachers and communities are vital to our success and the success for all children. So, Maestro Dudamel, can you start and tell us, you know, going back to that early childhood and what propelled you into this dream of the life that you're achieving and helping so many other people?
Well, Mary, thank you very much, first of all, and it's such an honor and a pleasure to be talking to you. And of course, you know, it's easy, but it's also very deep to talk about this because my love and my belief in music is because El Sistema program in Venezuela and Maestro Abreu. Of course, it starts with my father as a musician of El Sistema also. And that is why I think it's all a family connection, you know, because El Sistema is a family, and this is the way that works, you know. It goes, you know, generation and the other generation, and of course it was not difficult for me to be inspired by music, listening to my father playing and studying at home. But of course, I think everything got, I don't know if the word in English worked, redimension in the way that when I started to be in El Sistema, when I started to play with other kids, it became, you know, like, you know, the most beautiful and amazing thing that I was doing. And the fact that we are able, and that always comes to me, to my memories, you know, when you are inside of an orchestra. I remember that first time I didn't play. I played maybe three notes in the violin only, but they gave me, you know, the opportunity to be part of an orchestra. And when I was surrounded by all of these sounds, I remember I was in the last stand of the second violin section of an orchestra of 600 musicians. And it was huge because we were celebrating the anniversary of El Sistema in my town. And you know, that first moment when I was inside of all of that amount of beauty, you know, that was that sound, you know, it changed completely my life. And, you know, of course, immediately my teachers were my idols because I was following them. Maestro Abreu, you know, that was my mentor, is my mentor, is my guide, you know, in music and in life. So I think that was, you know, I think the genesis of all of this life in music.
You know, you've talked about your family, you talked about your community, and then you talked about the impact of the sound, right? And there's something, you know, we know that from our music research that it really does impact us profoundly, you know, neurologically, biologically, it really propels our entire being forward. Mm. You know,
absolutely.
So, So that's a one, and you know, last chair, second violin. That's pretty inspiring for a lot of people.
You cannot imagine. I was next to the horn section. You know, I was in the back. You know, that I remember, and I have the percussion really close, and I was, you know, it was magic. You know, I think it have been a beautiful journey to arrive to the podium.
So I know how proud you are to have Liliana Morales with us, and we're so grateful that she's with us too. Liliana, you've been a student of the Youth Orchestra of Los Angeles and the El Sistema program there. We'd love to hear your music education origin story. How did you, have the first opportunity, and what did it mean to you, and what did your first teachers mean to you?
I started with music when I was around 6 years old, and it all started because my dad wanted me to play the violin, and he's not a musician, but he taught himself how to read music and try to figure it out. It was like a puzzle to both of us. But I think my music career really started with YOLA and Harmony Project. And I think what really pushed it off was the Bienvenido Gustavo concert. That was really the first time that we had ever been a part of such a large concert, especially at the Hollywood Bowl. I think up until then, it was just family recitals and performing for friends. But I think what the really beautiful thing was throughout the entire process, and especially being so young, was, like Gustavo was saying, the community around music, around coming together. And especially for children and child development, I think that's absolutely crucial, being able to have sort of like a refuge and a safe space to just learn to be creative, to make mistakes, and to just be expressive. So I think that's how my music education started. And I'm really grateful to all of the teachers that helped us along the way. And I think I look back a lot on the Bienvenido Gustavo concert, because as an 8-year-old, it's really what put into perspective how broad and just how big the music world is. Because suddenly we were working with technicians and different orchestras and conductors, and it was just all a really incredible experience for me.
Well, that's wonderful. That's so, you know, and you have you are a few years younger than Gustavo and I are. So, and our experiences came, you know, at a different time, but it's wonderful that they're still important. You've both talked about peak experiences, right? You've talked about that there was something that sort of, you know, kind of biologically, emotionally, neurologically, that you all of a sudden said, you know, think about this more seriously, or go in this direction, or this is really important, right? I guess I would say, what type of experiences do we want to have available for every child, right? I mean, it might not be playing in the Hollywood Bowl, right? But even on the on the level that maybe is more local, what are the essence of what's important and is really transformative? Gustavo, would you like to start?
Well, yes, and I think, I think the most important thing, and it's something that, you know, we assume that is something, you know, it's a concept, a physic concept, but it's about beauty. I believe that music have is beauty. You know, the creation of all of these notes that maybe you don't know how to read notes, but you feel already, and they give and they send a message to you, a message that, you know, you interpret it in your own way. This is a digestion, I will say, of the soul. It goes directly to the soul, to the spirit, and then it creates, you know, an interaction that is unique. The interaction of an orchestra is unique, you know, and you can see in the fact that, look, you know, we play all different. We sometimes play better than others or less better than others. We play different instruments. Every instrument have a known characteristic, a different sound. But at the end, when you create something together, when you, you know, when you are inside of that, I will say sea, ocean of sound, and you are interacting in beauty, it creates, you know, a better spirit and a different vision of life for kids. This is the thing. It's not, and Liliana was saying something very important, that it's not about perfection. You know, it's not about perfection. It's about, you know, to deal or to live with something that is unique and that you can share and everybody will understand in their own context. That is the dimension of music. And we live in a world where we need more of that, you know, as part of the, you know, of the education of our kids. Because, you know, I feel that we educate our kids, you know, our children with a lot of technical things and all of that. But that part of, you know, creativity, but creativity together with a team, you know, this kind of inspiration that, you know, the action of playing with other gift to you or coming from the music is something that I think, you know, is very important for the evolution of a child, you know, in the education. I believe that. And that is what is YOLA, I think, you know. That is when you have Liliana, for example, in that concert that was 12 years ago, almost this year, she was little. She was a little, you have, I don't know, 7, 8 years. I don't remember, or something like that, Liliana. But she was playing next to musicians of the late Philharmonic. So there is not a border between, you know, if you are better or you are, no, you are playing together. You are creating that bridge that it creates beauty. So I think this is the most valuable thing of music, more than an entertaining element of society, is creation, is creation of beauty.
You know, when I hear you say these really important and passionate words, I'm driven to say we can't deny this experience for every child. Every child must mm-hmm. have these experiences on, you know, be it in choirs, orchestras, bands, community, you know, drum lines, mariachi groups. I mean, all the mm-hmm. things. You know, making music with the electronic environments and sharing them and writing, you know, there's just so many things that we want to make sure our children have access to. Liliana, kind of the same question to you in terms of the peak experience that you had that you want to make sure that is so important for every child. What would you say to that?
Well, I think similar to what Gustavo was saying, fundamentally, from the very beginning, music has always been about bringing people together and that community and those bonds that are built. And I remember growing up with YOLA, it's been over 12 years. For me, it was always about the memories I was able to create with my friends playing music together. And that's on and off stage. That's during rehearsal. That is during performances. And it's very much about there's a rush that you get when you're playing in your section and you're able to look across the section. I play the violin, so looking at the cello section and making that eye contact when we both know there's a flute solo, and knowing that we have each other, that there's trust, that we've all put an effort and practice to be here together. And I think it's really those moments that capture the essence and the beauty of music, because it's sort of an amalgamation of everything that we've worked for and everything that we're still working for and towards. And so I really think the peak experience is, like Gustavo was saying, about the community, about bringing people together, and about how it unites us all on and off stage. On stage, it doesn't matter what language you speak, who you're playing with, because you're all united through that fundamental language of music. And I think the peak experience was coming to understand that growing up and playing music, that once you get on stage and once you're performing and once you're playing and practicing, everything else sort of disappears and it dwindles, because the only important thing at that moment is feeling the music and expressing yourself and playing with others.
Liliana, you're so inspiring. Thank you for those wonderful words. So Maestro Dudamel, there's a lot of people in our audience who are conductors of various ensembles. They're music teachers, they train ensembles, you know, in sectionals and private lessons, and then they come together and they, you know, they do remarkable things with sometimes with very limited resources, but they are truly conductors and community leaders from their podiums. So the question I have for them really, are conductors born or are they made? And I also say that you jumped on the podium when you were 13, as I understand it, in a El Sistema ensemble, because I think the conductor was late. Was that right?
Yeah. And, yeah. So, I was a little younger.
A little younger. So maybe it is true conductors are born. So how would you answer that question? Born or made?
Look, I don't know, because it's a complex question. I have to say, because before I conducted an orchestra, a real orchestra, I was conducting as a game, as you know, playing with my toys at home. So I believe that for me, was very important to play in an orchestra. You know, to play in an orchestra, because it gave me the vision of the player in the orchestra. I was, of course, studying the violin and I was playing as a soloist, but the practice at the orchestra for me have been the most important thing. Watching the conductors, you know, analyzing, you know, the work. Remember that the conducting, the life of a conductor, the work, let's say, the action of conducting, is more psychological and philosophical than something technical. Because if we see all the conductors, they conduct differently. There are conductors that maybe they don't have a beautiful gesture or a clear gesture, but they made the orchestra play so together and so beautiful. And this is the thing. I think, you know, I have to say that the transition for me from to be a player to conduct, it was something very natural. And it was a game, because I was imitating conductors in the podium. That was my first time, my real first time in front of an orchestra. So I believe, you know, that also for me and El Sistema was very important, because I remember when I started to play in the first orchestra, the orchestra of the beginners, they call it at that time, Orquesta Iniciación. I remember I was studying, and a few months later, I went to the middle orchestra that was the previous one to the youth orchestra. But they made you teach. You know, when you went to the other orchestra, you had to teach the new ones. And you know, that gave, and you had to conduct the sectionals and all of that. So it was a very natural, I think, a path, you know, to arrive for me to be a conductor in an orchestra, to be conducting an orchestra. So to be say all of this, I think the conductor can be born, but also, you know, it can be made in the sense of working and, you know, guiding, you know, an orchestra or a choir or a band or, you know, whatever dimension you have as a group of musicians in front. So that is the most clear answer that I can give.
Well, I think it's a good answer. And also you've hinted at the, not hinted, you said very clearly that it's it's not necessarily about the most perfect baton technique, but it's this ability to connect with your players and build that integrity and build that musical, shared musical passion. I mean, I've looked at conductors over the years too. I said, how can anyone follow this conductor? And yet what's being produced is pristine and perfect and, you know, moves me. So Liliana, I want to ask you a question. What was it like being a student under Maestro Dudamel's conducting? What was that experience like for you? Most of us won't have that experience, Gustavo, but we'd love to hear from Liliana what the experience is like being in his orchestra.
Yeah, it was definitely a very beautiful experience, I would say. Every conductor is different. And I think some conductors really resonate with people because the passion really shines through. And I remember the first time we were working with Gustavo, I was very young. And so I think I've had the privilege of growing up and seeing and being under his baton quite a few times. And I think when I was younger, when I was around 8, 9 years old, what really resonated with me and with the orchestra, I could feel were the analogies. We played Hungarian dance, and it got to the part where the orchestra was kind of getting it. We were kind of falling apart. It just wasn't quite there. And he gave us an example of being ballerinas and that we all had to be very light and that we had to sort of come together and imagine that. And so the next time we played it, we got it. And I think the fantastic thing about that and what really resonated was that he sort of gave us his picture. He gave us a fragment of what he was thinking of in that moment. And so when he shared that and we were all thinking about that, it really brought everything together. And then at YOLA National during the summer programs, when multiple El Sistema sites from across the country come together in two beautiful orchestras, I think the really incredible thing about being under his baton there in a more advanced setting is again the passion and just how clearly everyone is able to attach to that and jump onto it and say, I know exactly what picture we're trying to create and what we're trying to portray. And I think the beautiful thing about being a musician and playing in the orchestra at that time is that everyone is feeling the same amount of energy in the room, and we're all trying to showcase it. And aside from just showcasing it, we're all really feeling it for ourselves. It becomes not so much about the audience as much anymore, but more about this just really is beautiful music, and we want to be a part of it, and we want to play it, and we want to feel the music and be a part of that.
So that's wonderful, Liliana. Thank you. And Gustavo, it really sounds like you're quite a teacher from the podium. You know, and these words are important for the teachers and our audience to hear as a reminder of how powerful their passion and their belief in what their students can do and their, you know, what the ensemble can do when all this comes together. So, Gustavo, you came to LA, and even before being appointed at the LA Philharmonic, you established the Youth Orchestra of Los Angeles, YOLA. When we say YOLA, this is what we're referring to. You started in 2007, and now you're serving over 1,300 students in the greater Los Angeles area. So tell us about YOLA, your ambitions, and why, you know, that's almost feels to me like it's equal, if importance, as all of your other international conducting experiences. This part of your work is extremely important to you. Tell us a little bit more about it.
Well, you know, YOLA is inspired by El Sistema in Venezuela, and was, I think, the beginning was the most important thing. I remember, you know, when Deborah Borda visited me in Venezuela, she was amazed. And I said, look, we were talking, and I said, look, the first thing that we have to do, and it's very important, I will go there, but we have to create something that connect us, you know, with the community in a deeper way. And because it was very important not only to see the lay field, you know, as an orchestra that plays concerts and you know, Disney and all of that, if not that the orchestra goes to the community, and this was and goes to the community to the heart of the community, that is the children, you know. And immediately we started at, you know, at Expo Center. I remember it was the first, it was the beginning of YOLA. And when I became music director, I remember, you know, this started to grow up. And it's about, look, this is about inclusion. You know, it's about to see that beauty that is music, that is art, is part of you. It's not only, you know, it's not, how to say in English, it's not only for some people that have the access for that, because sometimes you can see, especially classical music as that, as something untouchable, that is in a place where it's not part of you, it's not part of the identity, where, you know, when you go and you feel that you own that, you create an identity. And this is what YOLA give to the students, you know. It's an identity together. What a beautiful thing, you know, is to include a child that maybe is excluded because a social condition or whatever. And, you know, you give an instrument or you give the opportunity to sing or to play. You are giving, again, I go back to my first answer, you are giving, you know, a world of beauty. And this is YOLA. YOLA is transforming the community through beauty, through an interaction of beauty. And I'm very proud because little by little, we have been, you know, growing up and changing the life of the children. I remember in Venezuela, I was one of these children, you know. I remember, you know, since the very beginning, how much we were, you know, dreaming and we were fighting, you know, against, you know, the concept of this or classical music or this elitist thing or all of that. And, you know, it became something that is beautiful and expressed by Maestro Abreu. It's a right, you know, it's a human right. And when I see Liliana, for example, that is, you know, I would say a beautiful result of all of this, all of this journey through beauty. I feel very proud, and now it's great because now we will open this year our new center, YOLA Center in Inglewood. You know that is one of the most important things. I remember Maestro Abreu. I will tell you something that I live with Maestro Abreu, and it was when we have a beautiful building in Caracas called the Center for Social Action Through Music, Centro de Acción Social para la Música, and I remember Maestro Abreu. I don't know, 15 years ago or a little bit more, he took me to a empty land, and then he asked a brass quintet to play there, and then they started to play, and he looked at me and he said, like, what a beautiful acoustic. And I was like, this is an empty land, it doesn't have any kind of acoustic. Well, this was the land where is our Simón Bolívar Hall and all of this beautiful center for social action through music. So it was vision. And here we said something very important. The culture for poor children cannot be a poor culture. So the children that have access, it's like YOLA, the children that have access to this, or you are giving access, they need to have the best things. The best instruments, the best teachers, and the best spaces to create that. And I'm so proud because, you know, after these years, we are achieving something that was necessary, a center designed by Frank Gehry for all of this new generation to build their dreams. So this is YOLA.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing. And I love the helping us understand that we don't wait to provide beauty for our children, right? It's not till everything else has to be sort of in order and perfect. We need to start with beautiful experiences for them. So I could go on and talk to you for a long, long time, and I hope sometime we can. But I want to end with three short questions for each of you, a la presto, okay? Maestro Dudamel, what concert venue are you eager to return to?
Disney Hall.
Liliana, what concert venue are you easy to return to as an audience member, possibly, or a performer?
Hollywood Bowl.
There you go. What music? What music of any ensemble size are you hungry to perform? What music?
All the music, from Mahler, from Mahler, from Ligeti, from Adams to Vivaldi to Purcell to whatever.
Liliana, how about you?
A really big orchestra playing Tchaikovsky.
There you go. And what are you most hopeful for 2021? Gustavo? What are you most hopeful for 2021?
Well, that we can get together again and we can embrace each other's, you know, surrounded or embraced by the music.
Beautiful. How about you, Liliana?
That we continue being reflective. 2020, I think, was a year where we all really looked back and were appreciative and grateful for what we had. And I hope that once we're back together, that's still something we can carry on.
Thank you to both of you. Just a remarkable gift of our time together and all the ideas that you shared with our audience. Thank you so very much. And now we're going to take a moment to hear a piece by YOLA as they put together their virtual rendition of Somewhere from Leonard Bernstein's West Side Story. Thank you so much for being here for the Grand Rally for Music Education. Remember our motto, next year in Anaheim. Thanks for all you do to keep music education strong.